Okay, so before we kick into the documentary, I just got you guys' grades in for the camera movements assignment. It feels like it was a year ago now. I was very, very impressed, thoroughly impressed. And it's not as if students aren't really clicking and doing things at this time, but man, every one of them was showing a lot of progress, a lot of production value. If you guys wanted to pursue, a couple of them could probably play, you know, and screen at something, particularly Gage's, Gage Matthews, you know, Gage, second year. He runs the Communications Club, I think that's what it's called. The public speaking crew kind of puts that on. Well, I think they're gonna do two a year. I could be wrong, and I'll get some more information from Gage. But they like to have people come up, do poetry, have speech, play any sort of communication thing. So films was something that they were pretty excited about, and they found out we make a lot. I mean, dang, a couple of your guys' camera movement assignments would probably be great for that. I think they like you to go up kind of like film festival style and say, hey, here's my project, maybe answer questions, but I don't know if you're required to do that. I think it's pretty open. Most importantly, it's free. Maybe even more importantly, you're gaining an audience and getting more comfortable talking about your work and showing your stuff. I think it's a wonderful experience. So I don't know the exact dates on that. Does anybody know for sure? Has anybody talked to Gage about that? I'll have him come talk to class or something if he has that availability, or I'll get the time to. But that's kind of a film festival type, or you know, any sort of presentation. But they're open to about anything. I think some of your guys' films would be cool. Other than just the fact that you guys were getting down the core concepts of, if the camera moves, it should reveal something. If it's moving, it should move the story along. And I just saw a lot of that. It was really cool. Whether you're touring through the building, or doing like a promo, or telling something that's kind of a dark or sinister story, I just thought all of you guys were grabbing that core concept really well. It was a lot of fun to watch them, and I appreciate that as your teacher, because there's been times that I've sat down and watched a project and just gone, oh my gosh, what's the next one gonna be? After the first couple, I was legitimately like tickled to go to the next one, and it was a lot of fun. So thank you for just making grading a fun experience. And I hope with this documentary, it'll be even more empowering with story. If I give you the most time by far on this assignment that you would have had in any of my classes up to this point, the only class where I give you more time outside of your internships, that's really your thing, is the logistics production management class that you take before graduating, which where we spent the whole 16 weeks working on one project. With that exception, we really spend a lot of time on this. Documentaries are very, very time consuming, and there's only so much you can control. The real truth in life and trying to document that takes a little more research, takes a little more planning, takes a little more luck. And quite frankly, all these skills that you've been gaining throughout, whether it's camera movement, whether it's focus racking, just lighting the image correctly, depth of field, all of those should help you capture your story. And so the article that I gave for you guys to check out really did it from the cinematography perspective on documentary. I'm gonna talk about that a little bit. Especially my work as a cinematographer in documentary, but also I feel like they left out, did you guys read the article? I know probably like 1 out of 10 typically read that. They usually have, they keep mentioning throughout the cinematographer's job right here. The cinematographer is responsible. It's brought up over and over again. I think the cinematographer is vital. You don't have a story if you don't have an image or something to see, unless it's a podcast. But the editor and the producer and the director, and maybe they're considering the cinematographer kind of all of that all-encompassing. So if you read through this and you saw specifically on, and we're going to talk about this in more detail, on expository, where it says a cinematographer is responsible for collecting footage, I don't know any cinematographer that's ever pulled archival footage for me. And things like that. Do they record the interviews? Do they get demonstrations? Do they get the event, sport, wedding, whatever? Absolutely, and they're incredibly vital. Probably, definitely one of the most important. But the real person who carries the weight in a documentary is the editor. You're telling these stories backwards. So if you're in Joey's script writing class, take everything that you've done with your narrative fictional stuff and flip it around, because you got to gather all this information, you gather this story as best you can, you gather all this media or whatever it is, and then you have to find that what that story truly is in post. And that's what makes documentaries unique, and it gives a lot of power to that editor. So I want you to have that in your mind, that you're going to grab what you can, but when you get into post, your story might change. You might change during the process, especially if you choose one of the ones that you're participatory in. So let's get into the assignment first, get the dry stuff out of the way. This is what I had you guys looking at Thursday while I was trying to catch us up on some advising. Still can, if anybody's got any changes to make, we've got time. I do want to talk to you about how your conversation went. And I did a little more research, and so I think you kind of have options for going the public relations route. So. So looking at, I have a lot of material for you guys to consume if you are interested. Some of you I know probably have a story already and just want to hit the ground running. Some of you might not have any idea where you want to begin. And there's all these documentary subjects floating around you that you just haven't quite narrowed in on yet and you don't know. So when you're going through this, I have, Masterclass has some great stuff on there. From Ken Burns, you should watch the whole thing if you think documentary or journalism is a route you want to go, this type of storytelling. I've watched it a couple of times. I think it's a plethora of knowledge that I can't believe it's just sitting on Masterclass like that. Then Scorsese, obviously Scorsese is very, very well known for fictionals, filmmaking, and you know that narrative approach from that capacity, and some of the greatest ever. But he's also done some documentaries, and the ones I particularly picked are more about the first one, finding a story. So it could be fictional, it could be fact, or shooting low budget films. Some really great suggestions in there that I think all film students should absorb. We might watch some of those throughout some of these weeks when we're doing lectures and stuff, since I'll have more lectures. But I don't know which ones I want to show yet, and that might depend on where I see you guys going and what your needs are. If half the class is really struggling to find a story, then we might watch Finding the Story. If you all know where you're going to go and what you're doing next, then maybe we'll watch Shooting a Low Budget Film. It's all there for you. I think you should take advantage of all of it. Then, of course, Werner Herzog, one of my all-time favorites, and not just because I like his movies. He's one of my all-time favorites because of the persona that he has as a filmmaker, the energy he brings, and the way he tosses out rules, makes his own, and he's unapologetic about it. So even if you don't like it, that's on you. And I just think that's what an artist truly should be. And his whole one should be watched too, because he talks about acquiring funds. He talks about working with the different departments. And you can relay that information, whether it's fiction or nonfiction. And he's very well known for both. And so he has Shooting Strategy, I thought was a great one. And then he does talk, this documentary one starts a 4-part chapter. So it's the beginning. The last chapter of it is what I would recommend, but you should just check out all 4. Then we have Cinefix 10 Best. Obviously that's subjective, but I like that it points out several where I don't have. When I was in a film school that was very very theory-driven, we watched a lot, we talked a lot, we wrote a lot, we would have watched a couple of these. We don't have that kind of time because we're more production-driven. And, you know, hopefully Film Club takes some, you guys haven't seen any documentaries yet, I don't believe, right? No. And I should mention also, before I jump into the films that I just suggested, Adam, more about discussions. Adam listed, is this?
Yeah.
This is it. Adam listed out a lot of his different docs that he likes. And have you watched all of these, or some of the just research?
No, so, those are all of mine.
That's a lot. So if you're curious, and one of the things that's easy for us to do is get kind of wrapped up in our bubble. You know, if you're from the Midwest, if you're born and raised here, and some of you aren't, like Aaron's not from the Midwest, you might tell stories. It's good to tell stories that are around you. Get that information out. You know, find a nonprofit, a farmer, an artist. I've done a lot of local artists to help tell their story. But you should look and see what the stories are around the world. It's really fascinating. I think that helps you build like a base knowledge of what's happening around you, but also a little empathy for cultures you may not have experienced quite as much. I think traveling is really important for you to grow as a person, and I think this is one way you can afford to travel. You can watch documentaries from around the world. And one thing I don't get too far into, at least right now, because all the principles kind of work the same, at least at this particular point, is documentary series, shows, news, all anything that you're seeing that you're consuming that's factual has some capacity of documentary. So it's more broad than us just doing a quick short film that can be biographical or just factual in nature, or like the first one we'll watch from a poetic standpoint. So when you get it, if you want to take a chance, this is in the discussions. And I don't know, because I can't see from your perspective, if that flags so you guys get notified that there's discussions.
Yeah.
I see one head yes, one no. I use it all the time in my online class, like, you know, Callie's in my online class. And so we use discussions every week. Owen, you need to catch up on them. But in this class, I've never used it so much in the traditional format. That's awesome. So I appreciate you sharing that so they can take a look as well. Let me go back to Simon itself. So I shared a few in line. Documentary has been a big part of my work, whether it's commercial, and it's budgeted by a company, budgeted by a nonprofit, budgeted by a grant. Those are all different areas. But a lot of what I've done throughout my career was I really wanted to tell that story, didn't want to wait for money, found a camera, set up an interview, find some backstory, find some B-roll, find whatever, and just start doing it. And so I will show you, I want to first watch the CineFX 10 best. I don't like calling it 10 best any more than it should. So what we'll do, I want to watch this, and I don't know, we'll watch all of it. We're going to talk about the six areas, and they can be hybrid. It's okay if you mix and match your different areas, and maybe you have a little of mode one and mode four combined. And I think that's one of the beautiful things about documentary too, is that it can be absolutely unique to your story. It really isn't a best cookie cutter scenario like what you see for like reality TV and things like that. So we'll watch a couple and we'll talk about where they fall. Yeah, I don't want to watch all.
We've spent most of our time looking at narrative films, but just like pretty much everyone else in the world, we've been getting pretty into docs lately. So we figured it was time to take a deep dive. These are our picks for the 10 best documentaries of all time. Things off, we want to first look at that which feels like a documentary at its most traditional, the history doc. With moving, original, and fascinating looks at American history in Four Little Girls and 13th, non-American history in Nostalgia for the Light and West of the Tracks, at the Vietnam War in The Fog of War and Hearts and Minds, and the World Wars in The Sorrow and the Pity and They Shall Not Grow Old. We love 20 Years Later, The Act of Killing, The Look of Silence, and The Cave of Dreams. But at the very front of the pack, we think there is perhaps no more moving document of the past ever created than our first pick, Shoah.
Fraser, ten another. La Sfar Shiva. Da waren gebrennt Leute, viele Leute waren hier verbrannt. Ja, das ist das Platz.
Standing at nearly 9.5 hours long, Claude Lanzmann's Shoah is a towering act of witnessing, a shocking combination of the stories told by victims, bystanders, and perpetrators, some of these against their wishes and without their knowledge. Shoah is, on its face, a simple film, hardly more than oral history, but in its execution, its prosaic tapestry woven of many personal narratives, its quiet imagery of places that are truly haunted, what eventually emerges is more than just a historical tragedy, the stuff of books and facts and statistics, but the unmistakable echo preserved as if in amber of many real moments in many real human lives. It is immensely difficult but never dull, beautiful despite so much heartbreak, and important, so very important, maybe more so than any other historical document ever made. After history, our minds next wander to the realm of the social.
Look at it from that. Okay, 9.5 hours. Clearly, no one just sat for 9.5 hours and watched a film straight through. And I wonder if, you know, since it was from the 80s, if that might have been more of a series nowadays, if the producers would have chopped it up and made it, you know, put it into different sections. But quite frankly, sometimes you just don't have the ability to. You may not have the crew, the equipment, the money, whatever, the time that you can do that. And so sometimes you just lay it down and put it together. And in this particular case, what made it really special was they were capturing stories before they disappeared. It's great when someone can sit and write out their life story and explain, like, this is what happened. But it's very rare. We've even had cases where lawyers have brought us in before to do, like, a last will and testament because their client was so ill about the past that they couldn't even write that out. And so they wanted to just record it. So not everything you document is going to be the Academy Award, best film, most exciting, most controversial. Sometimes you're just gathering story and you're building it up. And there's been a lot of time, we've filmed a lot of people who are now passed on, and we have one of the last accounts of their stories for whatever reason. So please don't do a 9-hour documentary. 9 minutes is pushing a lot of short films. So there's a lot that you can tell in a lot less time. But sometimes when you're talking about atrocity like war crimes and stuff, it's not about the entertainment value, it's about gathering that message so that you can pass it on like a historical reference.
Documentary, beginning with the earliest of innovators, Nanook of the North and Land Without Bread, to the later standouts in...
So Nanook of the North, I had to watch in its entirety in film school, and then another teacher made us watch most of it, so that was productive, and it was roughly 3.5 hours or something like that, one of the earliest forms of documentary, and technically the first film shot with like people leaving a factory, trains rolling across, technically they're documentary observationally. But Nanook of the North really told a story about these Eskimos, about far, far North America, and it was pretty interesting in the capacity that they had a film crew out in 1920 documenting this stuff in the frozen tundra. But it was something that I like to just give you that kind of little tidbit on it and not make you watch 3 hours of people building an igloo. And the other thing is they rifle through these pretty fast, but they mention some really great films.
In high school, Diest, Paris is Burning, and the real-life boyhood of the Up series. Salesman and Chronicle of a Summer are probably the gold standards of the social documentary form, but in terms of endless watchability, our second pick goes to Harlan County, USA.
I had the boss man say one time, he said, "You be sure, don't get that new, and I don't know a place where the rock will fall in on him." I said, "Well, what about me? I was driving a mule in. What about me? The rock and falling on me." He said, "We can always hire another man." He said, "You've got to buy that mule."
Harlan County, U.S.
So I'm not going to get into this too much today because we're more about just kicking this off. But that guy in a rocking chair is like 9 different wrongs if you can control that. When I was taught the interview process by Madison Lacey in film school, he's an Emmy-winning producer with Ken Burns on several of his projects. He wouldn't even let someone sit in a chair that would have like that was too comfortable that you could just sit back in and kind of fall asleep in. He wanted to put him on a stool and something without a back or something almost uncomfortable for that matter, just so that they're engaged in the story. You'd never want to put them on something wheels. You don't want to put them on something that moves. Why? More than one reason, right answer. What do you guys think? Sorry, what?
Framed.
Yeah, framed. Focus. That guy moving back and forth. Now, he was outside, so he's going to have a larger depth of field, right?
What about me? The rock is falling on me. He said, "We can always hire another man."
And that guy is not in the mood to be coached. I can tell you that much. You can just tell by the 2 seconds he's talking there. And this happened to us in Africa last fall. My brother knows very well not to frame someone up sitting next to a wall. He knows that drives me crazy. I need some depth there. I don't like hard shadows and those kinds of things. This guy wasn't moving. This is my chair. This is where my chair goes. This is where you will talk to me. And he was a very important interview. And I appreciated David's candor in working with that, even though he knows that that's not how we would frame up an interview. if that in fact is going to work in your favor, and they will take some direction. But not all stories are going to. So this guy rocking in his chair probably wasn't something the producer and the filmmaker, any of them, wanted to lose that battle for. They wanted to get that story. Documentary has a lot of exceptions. There's a lot of rule breaking in order to get the truth and the real story. If he was an actor and it was a reenactment, then the only reason might have him in that chair is if he was playing somebody that wouldn't do anything but rock in his chair. So these are some of the things we'll talk about throughout the month. That the most important thing to take from it is there's no right way to do a documentary as long as you get that story. But there's things that I do most of the time when I'm able to, and that would have been one of those things. Let's not have you rocking in that chair. Let's get you, sit on this bench. Just be a real quick interview. Wearing glasses is another thing. The reflections are super distracting, and I want to see the eyes and the windows to the soul. But if they wear glasses all the time, then work around that. Try to move your lights around. Try to position them so the reflection is not so bad. Get a polarizer filter. There's ways to do that. But ultimately, if it's like me wearing glasses for a blue light filter, just ask them to take it off. That's not going to offend anybody. So those are some of those things that you'll start to learn through this process too. That'll help you be more successful as you keep moving.
Country's pastime like Ken Burns' baseball, to delightful looks at little niches like Murderball. From portraits of an entire career as in Senna, to slices of a moment in sports history as in When We Were Kings. There's Freedom's Fury, Touching the Void, and the only kind of racist Olympia. But it really doesn't get any better than the genre-defining, trophy-holding, all-time all-star of Hoop Dreams.
When I get in the NBA, first thing I'm gonna do, I'm gonna go see my mama, I'm gonna buy a house, and I'm gonna go there and make sure my sister and my brother's okay. Try to get my dad Cadillac. Oldsmobile, so I can cruise in the game.
Two inner-city eighth graders are recruited straight off the playground by talent scouts for a suburban prep school. For the next 6 years, we watch them grow, struggle, commute 90 minutes each way, succeed, fail, and ultimately strive to travel the long road from where they are to the realization of their dreams. And we have unprecedented access to their journey. These are young children dreaming as children do, invited into a demanding world of expectations and results and disappointment, all on the precipice of adulthood. They become two very human faces on a very real American dream. After sports, we got
sports. So much time, money, passion put into that, and we have a concept for one talking about sports from different ages, all the way to sports of the future like drum racing and things like that. Esports is evolving so much, and we have Alex Rodriguez. He's been following some esports around. Jason Anderson, who is here this semester, but interviewing with the hockey team in Phoenix. He actually got to go to Korea, South Korea, to do a documentary with an esports team. Sports can take you around the world. There's a lot of money in it. There's a lot of passion around it. This one in particular is really fascinating that they followed two kids for 6 years. That's one of those really long commitments. And documentaries sometimes are like that. I have one currently that I started in 2017. It's getting close, but man, it's taken a long time. And there's a lot of people who would like to see it, but I can't release it until it's done right. You guys don't have that luxury. I'm giving you a deadline. Sometimes you just got to finish it off. But there's nothing wrong with that. My nature stuff, I might add nature footage from 10 years ago in an upcoming chapter. I'd like to collect that library. So some documentaries you're always telling. What I find really interesting about the timing here, this documentary came out in 94. What was released in 2020, Michael Jordan's story, The Last Dance, was shot in like 96, 97, and then it took him a couple decades before they did the editing. But it's hard, and maybe it's coincidental, but I kind of don't think so. when this comes out in 94, and it's fascinating, and they see this development of these kids going over 6 years from junior high into these advanced leagues. I'm sure that really drove home for the producers on The Last Dance. I just can't imagine that wasn't in the back of their head. One of the things you should do and Adam's list is a good starting point, videos like this as well, is you should consume some other stories. If you're gonna tell a story about an artist that's a painter, then look at some documentaries about some other painters. If it's gonna be about a politician, then look up some other stories about politicians. War, sports, anything, true crime. Endless cycle of all of it, but whatever you decide you're gonna tell, consume some other stuff and learn it, because no one's talking about this particular film, but I have a hard time thinking The Last Dance wouldn't be that without some influence from some other sports films, particularly that. And that's an opinion, but, you know. So the first one I'm going to show you of mine is a poetic, so I'm going to look at
documentary filmic, the expositionless audio-visual collage that really does just observe and document and make no judgment beyond inclusion and assemblage. There are the early examples, Man with a Movie Camera, and Berlin, Symphony of a Metropolis. Later we find meditations on mirages in Fata Morgana, insects in Microcosmos, and fishermen in Leviathan. We find the work of Godfrey Reggio, the Cozzi Trilogy, and Visitors. And then there is the work of his one-time cinematographer, Ron Frick, whose Samsara we called the most beautiful film of all time. We still think it is, and if we hadn't gushed about it so much already, it might easily snap up this slot. But fortunately for us, it has a just as good, if not better, older brother in the form of Baraka. Gorgeous minutes, Baraka eschews all language in its ambitious attempt to reach its arms impossibly wide around the entirety of our Earth and wrap it up all at once, immersing us in the vastness of its sights and sounds and rhythms and combinations, striving for the universal through the narrowest of specifics. Earth, humanity, individuals, culture, commodity, worship, often haunting, sometimes tragic, sometimes glorious, but always beautiful. Baraka is the crowning achievement in poetic documentary cinema, building upon Koyaanisqatsi's rhythms and eye, and outlining the basic themes that Samsara would eventually go on to develop. It truly is a spectacular testament to the immense majesty of this thing called life.
So, what a beautiful film, and the way that can showcase life in a very poetic way. Couldn't have a better example for poetic documentary. They briefly, just so briefly, and this is one I told Joey he should show us about.
Later we find meditations on mirages in Fata Morgana, insects in micro...
So Microcosmos was a big
find meditations on
for the film I'm about to show you. And it was done, and it says 96, I've seen it listed otherwise, by a French filmmaker. And the whole thing takes place over the course of what would be a day in a field in France. All from the very microscopic to... I think like the largest thing in it is like a pheasant, which is very French to have one in anyways. And my brothers and I have watched this film so many times, we own like 3 DVD copies of it. It started with stealing it back and forth, and we literally watched it so much we ruined the DVDs. So we ordered it. I think I have a digital copy on Amazon now. This film has absolutely inspired me, probably as much as any in particular film. And so when I show you my poetic documentary, you'll definitely see why I say that. So from our first, let's look at the article real quick. For the poetic mode, for the 6 different modes that are discussed, keep in mind, this is what, you know, one film critic listed it as, and I think it is pretty encompassing, but for poetic documentary, it shows linear continuity in favor of mood, tone, and juxtaposition of imagery. So there's several examples that they make. Well, they only mentioned Leni Riefenstahl's, which is, she was incredible. She was Hitler's filmmaker and really put him on the map with political stuff, but she was absolutely groundbreaking with her film techniques. So when I watched Microcosmos as a kid hundreds of times, just see all these beautiful imagery, they have a slight bit of narration right at the beginning, just a little bit, just to kind of like lay the groundwork, and then the rest you just absorb, and you just observe, and you let the story play out through beautiful cinematography. and what is the course of what supposedly is one day, as far as the story goes. But clearly, they shot some things in some tanks and plants growing and snails and stuff that were going, yeah, that probably wasn't done actually in the field. But it's just beautiful anyways. So mine, Microcosmos, Microkansas, which, you know, definitely stealing from, let me play it first and you'll see why it's my one poetic documentary.
Thank you, Bobby. That was a beautiful film.
Yeah, thank you. And it was suggested by, you know, one of my friends, actually Jaden's uncle. He was like, oh, now you just need a British narrator to come in and do a voiceover. But that was exactly what I didn't want. I didn't want somebody coming in and distracting from what was actually taking place. And so it's ironic, but my most successful film is also my luckiest film. So, but like my brother said, you gotta put yourself out there. I was saying how I got so lucky to get that shot, and he was like, you were out there 10 straight days in a row and didn't get anything. So is it luck or is it just you know, putting yourself in that field? And that's one of the things about documentary. If it was easy, then I would just throw frogs at a snake all day long and hope that eventually, you know, I'd land something. But putting yourself out there, and we filmed snakes eating other snakes, snakes eating frogs, snakes eating fish. We have documented all that, but sometimes you get, you know, something really unique and lucky. It'd be crazy not to call it at least somewhat lucky, right? But the idea of it being poetic, the story is told through cinematography and editing and music, but not distracted by any. The only other element is two graphics, you know, for the title and for myself. But yeah, I had a lot of fortune with this film. It's intended to be a way longer series than a way longer documentary, whichever works out. But I just happened to be quarantined in 2020. I'd been sitting on the footage for 3 years before I finally had time where I couldn't even come in the building. So I was able to finally finish this thing. So that's the other reason you save everything, because you know, sometimes you have stuff like this, but you never know. Obviously the footage throughout that leads into the story to kind of set up the sinister, dark mood with stuff I accumulated for years even before that. And some of it I'd shot literally while I was quarantined. So the footage is from all different areas. Yeah, Dayton.
How long did it take you to get the footage of the snake getting the frog and trying to eat the frog? And
oh, yeah.
The other frog, and then the other frog jumping the snake.
So that's probably one of the most common questions I get, whether it's like a reporter or a film festival discussion or something. It was about 40 some, just on low 40 minutes of the actual fight, and then I cut it into about three. So I used about 10%, which is pretty common. So that's when we start talking about ratios. A documentary is going to have way larger ratios than a narrative fiction film where you tell your actor, you block out your scene and you have them come in through the door. And so in this case, about a 10% ratio on that, where the snake, from when I first, Leah was pawn, she was chasing frogs and she was wanting to catch them, and this frog wasn't running and it was annoying her. She just kept pawing. And I was like, what has she got? I thought it was like dying. I guess it kind of was. And it ended up, there was a snake on the other end. The pawn is so gross that you couldn't see it. And so I shoot her off to go find other frogs. And that was when I started documenting it. And I got lucky that the snake wanted to pull it out of the water to eat it, which they do. But normally we catch them when they're already out in the water. So a lot of luck there. And she's actually the one who chased the frog that jumped into the snake. That was her chasing a different frog. So Leah deserves probably a little bit of credit for setting up the scenario. But yeah, Poetic is the first, I'm trying to get to my spot here. Poetic is the first mode that we discussed. I don't know if I'd say it's the most common. When you look at the six, there's so many different documentaries and so many ways to tell it. And most of mine are not poetic. This is really, other than just like a full montage, I do have some others that I guess would fall into that category. But I use them for things like grant proposals and you know, maybe it's a hype video. You could argue all of the sports promos are mostly poetic documentaries in nature. The next one I want to show you is more expository, and it's longer. And it is a little longer, and definitely took a whole lot more man hours, research, travel, equipment, audio people, editors. We spent a ton more money on it, and I don't know. It's arguably working its way into being as successful as Micro Kansas. It's a little younger, so we're still finally. It's a little younger, so we're still getting, it's still out in the festival circuit. And I'll talk a little bit more after we watch this one. So this is probably one of my favorite expositories that I've produced.
That was the most sickening thing a person could watch. And anybody that was there probably has nightmares to this day.
When that fire happened and three or four people was burned bad.
We had to get down off of the rec room between turn one and two because of the heat. In 1974, something had happened with Merrick and the Hutchinson Fire Department, and there was no fire rescue there.
And Jack told me this. He said that I knew when I was in the fire and I got up on top of the car to jump out. He said I knew which direction to go, but he said I was burning. I was burning, and right when I was ready to jump off, a gas tank in the car next to me exploded. It knocked me back into the car, and he said, I knew it, and I said it to myself, if I don't get back up there again and make this jump this time, I'm not going to get out of here.
The Hudson Nationals has been a staple to that city for a long time. That echo, you could hear the race cars anywhere in the city of Hutchinson when they're racing at Kansas State Fairgrounds because of that 10,000 seat grandstand and the roof over that grandstand that throws the noise out. Drivers have told me that they can hear the cars when they get on the front straight. That's part of the stigma of that whole place. You know, it's the fact that it's got the biggest, baddest, fastest half-mile racetrack around that I've ever been to. It doesn't get run on other than just certain times of the year.
The emotion that it takes place because guys gear up all season long. There are some guys that keep a car just for the Hutch Nationals. This racetrack is 190 years old. I mean, there's not a lot of race facilities that are open that long that survive.
No place else around the Midwest has a concrete retaining wall around it. Nobody has 10,000 seat arena that you get to race in front of. So those things make it very unique. Just the opportunity of going so much faster on straightaways and things like that, and the uniqueness of getting to go somewhere and do something different. Kind of like for a lot of people to understand, it's more like the Indianapolis 500.
I raced 46 years. My brother raced for 53 years, and probably 40 or so of those years I raced at the Nationals. It was the Daytona 500, the Indy 500, all bound together because you would have race cars coming in from all over. You would get to race against some of the people you only read about in Speed Sports and some of those magazines, and it was just tremendous to be able to pit your abilities, your crew, your equipment against them to see how you fared. Always loved it. Crowds were fantastic. It was a home run for Hutchinson.
This is something that you don't know what's going to happen over there. Drivers have said time and time again, Kansas State Fairgrounds half mile with that wall around the top, as fast as you go down those straightaways, you can take any car you want, a late model stock car, a sprint car, a modified, and if things don't go right, and that car doesn't turn when you go into turn three or turn one, you can take what's left of it home in a paper bag.
The speeds are higher, faster, you have more mechanical breakdowns because of the high RPMs of the motors. You've got tire wear because there's a lot of sand built in this dirt, you know. There's so many things that factor into winning the Hutch Nationals. It's a lot of luck.
It's not like the short tracks that you race against a guy every weekend and you can put a fender on him and get him loose, or worse yet, spin him out. You got to drive to the best of your ability, and it's not just a matter of going out and tearing up somebody's equipment, because that's not winning. That's just a situation there that all you're doing is creating chaos. Doesn't matter if it's in Hutchinson, Kansas, or if you're in Daytona, it's the same concept. To those people who are there, the fans who are there, the racers who are there, it's the same momentum, it's the same excitement. It's just a different track.
There, you're parked out in a field, basically behind the grandstand. So you see the back of it, but you get pushed through a tunnel. And all of a sudden, you're pushed out, and there's this grand old half mile with 223 6-foot cement walls staring at you. And there's a 10,000 seat grandstand, and it's like a metamorphosis that takes place. It's all of a sudden, it's like a racehorse, like Secretariat. It's getting ready to run in the biggest race even to win the Triple Crown. That's what these guys are like. The heartbeat's faster. All of a sudden, you're not at any more speedway anymore. You got 1 weekend to do your best to win the Hutch Nationals. And you get one shot of winning. And it's an adrenaline rush that precedes no other racing form around this area.
There's certainly been, you know, a lot of fun and glory and a lot of history with it, and unfortunately there's been some bad times.
Not a favorite story, but the fire in 1974.
When that fire happened and three or four people was burned bad, you know, it turned into a pretty messy situation.
That was the most sickening thing a person could watch. And anybody that was there probably has nightmares to this day.
Jack Petty was racing at Hutchison, and Jack was somebody that I'd raced against a number of years, had some success against him. He was good. Right at the start of the 50-lap Grand National event, it was a dusty, dirty track, and cars started piling up. Fire broke out, and Jack was badly, badly burned, almost lost his life.
I actually drove Jerry Soderberg, who was one of the drivers that was burned real bad. We took him down into the hospital emergency room and went by the one driver who later I found out was Jack Petty. Didn't know who he was. Absolutely didn't know he had been burnt so bad.
I was there with my dad, but at that time I was still young enough, I couldn't even go in the pits. And I was on the third row of the bleachers. And the heat, the smell, the fire, it was sickening.
The second explosion that we heard, we had to get down off of the rec room between turn one and two because of the heat. In 1974, something had happened with Merrick and the Hutchison Fire Department, and there was no fire rescue there.
With me and co-host Roger Thompson, we're visiting with Jack Petty. This is you jumping out of that fire. So the fire is happening, and it's got to be life-threatening. You knew it was life-threatening to you.
Well, I knew I had to get out of there by myself because nobody could get in there. It was so hot. When I'm doing the leap for life, as they call it, from the top of my car, which you can't even see in that fire. And I landed in that little space right there at the edge of the fire, the only place I could have landed, and that was strictly luck.
And as soon as he jumped, why, his pit crew that helped him, Jack had ran a late model earlier that day, they ran over and grabbed him and pulled him back, and they got burned. And so then from there, Jack was taken off to the burn center.
They wrapped us in sterile sheets, put us in body bags, and filled the bladder bags with ice, and took us to the airport there in Hutchison. At the same time we got there at the airport, Army helicopter from Fort Riley landed, a medical helicopter, and flew us to Kansas City.
That day Jack was wearing combat boots. He didn't have any fire suit on, open-faced helmet. There was already the push going on, so, well, we want you to have in-car extinguishers, fuel cell, racing suits. And so we can't do all that. Racing suits like $200. We can't afford to spend that. And when that accident happened and that footage came out and those people that we knew who were almost lost their lives, there wasn't a word said about the safety equipment. Everybody got the fire extinguisher, the fuel cells, the racing suits, and took that part serious, because up until then, it wasn't unusual. If I raced at Topeka, I'd be wearing a pair of shorts and you know, a t-shirt and stuff like that. You know, you didn't have full respect for it.
I had a 20% chance of surviving, and the people up there have got nothing but good to say about them. They literally saved my life and a lot of other people's lives. I saw saved up there. It took me quite a while to heal up and several reconstructive surgeries. And I was able to go back racing for 3 more years and race just as successfully as I had before. There's always something good comes out of tragedies. The good thing is the next year there were more safety issues put into place. Fire suits were mandatory, fuel cells were mandatory, so I'm just glad to be here.
That's something I'll never forget. Never forget, because it was the most horrific thing I've ever seen in auto racing. And it just reminds you what kind of sport this is. It's as safe as it can be. It's being made safer all the time. Every time something happens, something good comes out of it for the sport in respect to how do we protect the lives of the drivers, the crew members, the fans, and everybody else. It was definitely a situation that brought a lot of the manufacturers to the forefront to say, we can do better than this, and they've done a lot better than this.
So we're talking about second, third, and fourth generation drivers, that this is all they know. They have normal jobs during the day, and then they gear up all week for their Friday or Saturday night, and naturally there's no difference. There's so many big races in here. We have the Air Capital Shootout here, we have the Kings Royal, they have the Knoxville Nationals, and I'm telling you, the Hutch Nationals is one of those races that goes in that same category. It's the Indy 500 and the Daytona 500 in this area of racing for dirt cars.
So there's a lot to unpack with that particular story. The runtime is just over 12 minutes, and if you if you were to take out kind of that intro, kind of that prelude leading into the story, and you take out that really lengthy title sequence at the credit list, then it would be, I can't remember what the time, but it would be under that 10-minute mark where you guys would be at. So. If you take out those two fluff pieces that took a really long time to edit, to be perfectly frank, then 10 minutes is a long story if you look at how much we covered in ours. And so next year is the 50th anniversary for the fire and kind of what all took place. And now they're fighting really hard to save the track, not demo the track, which is where this story began, actually. My partner is all into racing. Doing it his whole life. When we were in college together, his Indy team through the engineering department actually won nationals in 2012. So motorsports has been his world forever. And of course we do a lot of other things, but this was kind of Patrick's passion as we started digging into these stories, because he intends it to be a feature length story about the history of the track, hoping to build an audience enough to save the track, help in whatever way we can. Documentaries can have a lot of different purposes. As we sat through these interviews, and my dad was there in 70, for the fire in 74, and several other people, many obviously we interviewed several. As we were getting into this story towards the very early days in our first interviews, I was just telling Patrick, I want to direct the chapter on the fire. I was so pumped about that. There was so much to unpack from the fire. To me, that was the story that was the most exciting. The track's super old, the track's really long, it has this crazy concrete wall, a lot of famous people have raced there. But to me, the story that was most fascinating was the fire. So fast forward a couple more years, we've been in production on this, kind of starting around 2018. And that's why you see so many names. A lot of people helped as they've come through the program, been a part of our social base with the film community. As we made more connections, that led to other organizations that had archival footage, photos, media, whatever, articles that helped for research. But we got hit up because people were finding out that we were working on it. It was coming up in conversation. And one of the film festivals actually contacted us because they had a car category. This is where that networking is so vital, even though it worked out in a not expected way. They contacted us and asked if we had anything ready because they had like two or three car films and they really didn't have enough for a full block at a film festival. It's important you guys start attending these festivals when you have opportunities so you can kind of get a peek into that world. And so when they contacted us, they were like, you guys don't have to pay, just please enter it, and we'd be happy to screen it. We'd screened at this festival plenty of times, so they knew our quality and they enjoyed us, or otherwise they wouldn't invite us, I suppose. So we power in, we don't have much time, and we try to start telling this story over just like a really long, how do we cut down our feature? Let's just do a chapter of it. So this chapter ended up becoming a short film. We did not end up screening this film that year at that festival. They ended up changing their mind and not doing the car category. That was so frustrating. We just paid an editor to start assembling all this. We had $1,000 and people working on it. And then they couldn't finish and they stepped away from the project, more than one editor. And so I came in and I put hundreds of hours into what you see now. And we said, okay, we're not getting into this one, which was Doc Sunback this year. We had a different film in, so it wasn't all a loss. We were going anyways. But a lot of time and energy got just all of a sudden just pushed into this thing that we weren't planning on putting that time into. And so then I decided, screw it, let's try to hit the Tallgrass deadline. It was like 3 weeks later. So after we didn't hit Doc Sunback, went and had fun, saw our friend Mike Kansas actually played it that year. And then we made the deadline. We had to pay extra, but we got into Tallgrass with this film on the last day that they're accepting films, which is really rare that a top 40 festival is gonna take anybody on the last day. Usually you gotta pull some strings for that to work. Normally they have their films all picked. So then fast forward one more year, we enter into Doc Sunback, the festival that asked us to make it, and it won. Pat was there this year and we got best film. So it was a year prolonged. Some late nights, a lot of no sleep, especially in my world. I have to wait till the kids are asleep where I can really crunch in on some editing most days. So we're very proud of how it ended up. And then it just recently got nominated for Best Short Documentary in London at the Motor Film Awards, which we were invited to. And my mistake, my passport expired while we would have been on the trip, so I ruined it for us. Keep your passport fresh. It's a lesson there. 10 years goes by fast. So there's a lot encompassing this. You saw dozens of people credited, lots of hours, lots of time, and it's not even close to what his vision is for the end result. So some of these stories, you might just turn it in for that deadline, being at the end of the month for us. That doesn't mean the story has to be over for you, though. So like my brother, when he took this class a year ago, he did a nature film for the documentary side. Pretty standard for one of the Obermeyers to do a nature film. Definitely not the end of that story for him either. So, any questions about the Grand Nationals story? So in this one, that's where it's definitely, and most, actually pretty much all of mine except for a couple poetic, are in the expository mode. Expository set up specific points of view or argument about a subject. Often featured a voice of God, which in this case we didn't use a narrator, but the drivers who lived it kind of told their story, including some that had it passed on, and we had to find archival video from like 15 years ago just to see that we could get Jack Petty on camera, because he died way before I was even back living in Hutch. Anyway, fun Hutch. But so this is where I'm a little perplexed, because I was cinematographer, director of photography on this film. And trust me, it was a ton of work, and we wouldn't have it if we didn't do that. But so for expository documentaries, the cinematographer is responsible for collecting footage that supports and strengthens the spoken argument of the film, including stock footage, archival B-roll, reenactments, historical events. And I have to say, I had way, way, way more time in as an editor than anything else. Hundreds of hours there. As a producer, nothing ran unless Pat and I, you know, did our shot list, got our questions ready, had set up the equipment, got our crew, made the arrangements, travel, whatever. budgeted for meals and budgeted for labor. We had way more time in it than I did as a cinematographer, setting up lights and getting that shot. So I don't know why that's where they described that. I really wanted to hit that today because, yes, the cinematography is imperative or we wouldn't have our story. All the shoots at the track, all of the stuff that we've done, all the favors we pulled and everything. Yeah, there's a lot of visual stuff that we pulled off, but the editing is what put that story from the hard drive into a linear thing that people could follow and take them back to that event. and then it goes on to say people like Ken Burns uses photos, facts to supplement causes and impact. So it's definitely hitting in that note. I just didn't really like that it makes it sound like cinematography was the all-encompassing role there. And people's definition of cinematographer is different depending on who you talk to too. So I'm going to show you one more, and then what I want you to help me figure out is which one of the four we haven't done yet that it is. And this came from Leonie Weinkomper. She was one of our German students. As German as my name is, my language is pitiful when it comes to that. Leonie made Nature Communicates. Actually, she produced Nature Communicates in our production management class. So keep in mind, this was not in studio and field. She did this the following semester. It was just the way it worked out. Most of you, I prefer you take production management your second year. In her case, because she was just doing a year with us and then going back to Germany, she kind of rifled through a lot of the program and kind of picked what would work. But she was incredibly advanced with the camera, had all the punctuality and tenacity it took to live in the lab and edit. That semester that she made this, I was teaching post one in the lab, and we had one empty seat in that class. She was there almost every class period working on this. translating for captioning alone was like a 9-hour sit down, trying to get that kind of stuff figured out. But I want you to watch it. It's 6 minutes long. It's one of my favorite films produced in the program. This actually, and I couldn't tell you the university, but by the way that it works in Europe with their credits in America, they have more of a point system and we have more of a letter, you know, kind of system. None of her credits transferred back. So when she went back to Germany, she basically had her portfolio and this film got her into a really prestigious film school that she said is really, really low acceptance rate. And she credits this film for being that is in her resume is what got her into that in that mold. So we'll watch it and I'll talk a little bit more about the logistics and production side to it and some of the hell that she went through trying to make this because it was a lot of work. And I'm incredibly proud of where she ended up with it.
Heute habe ich einen Spaziergang durch den Wald gemacht. Mir kamen Gedanken über meine Zukunft in meinen Kopf, über meine Chancen und Wege, die ich einschlagen kann. Es gibt mir einen freien Kopf, wenn ich draußen bin und einfach nur zuhöre. Alles in der Natur hat ihren speziellen Platz und ihren speziellen Zweck. Die Natur verschwendet keine Energie, sie spendet sie. Dass ich meine Antworten über meine Zukunft in der Natur finde. Alles ist verbunden. Nicht nur die Verbindungen durch Social Media und neue Technologien, die wir kennen. Nein, ich meine hier, direkt vor meinen Augen. Da ist vielleicht dieser eine Baum, der so aussieht, als würde er den anderen Bäumen überlegen sein. Weil er der größte ist und somit am meisten Licht aufnimmt. Einer würde sagen, er kämpft nur für sich. Der Wald ist ein komplexes Netzwerk, mit der Fähigkeit, Rückmeldungen und Verbesserungsvorschläge an andere Bäume weiterzugeben. Ich vergleiche das mit dem Austauschen von Hausaufgaben in der Schule. Ich möchte, dass mein Partner mir hilft und sagt, was ich das nächste Mal besser machen kann. Vergleichbare Interaktionen geschehen im Wald. Die wichtigste Rolle gilt den Mutterbäumen, denn diese können mit bis zu 100 anderen Bäumen verbunden sein. Es ist kein großer Unterschied in Beziehungen von Familien in der Natur und in der menschlichen Welt. Mutterbäume zum Beispiel ernähren ihre Nachkommen, indem sie Nährstoffe durch ein unterirdisches System leiten. Dieses System nennt sich Mykorrhiza und erhöht die Lebenschance 4-mal. Mutterbäume erkennen ihre eigenen Nachkommen und entwickeln eine bessere Informations- und Nährstoffleitung zu ihrer Art. Wie ich gesagt habe, kein großer Unterschied. Wissen, Weisheit und Liebe sind die wichtigsten Geschenke, die man durch andere Wesen erreichen kann. Der Natur ist der Wert von Erfahrung anderer bewusst. Deshalb teilen Bäume ihre Weisheiten und Verteidigungssignale mit ihren Sprösslingen. Der Austausch von Informationen senkt den zukünftigen Stress der Nachkommen und ist ein Beweis, dass Bäume kommunizieren. Meiner Meinung nach kopieren wir all unser Verhalten von Mutter Natur. Meine Familie mein Mutterbaum ist. Und diese Erkenntnis schenkt mir Vertrauen in mich selbst. Aber mir ist bewusst, dass ich meinen eigenen Weg gehen muss, um ebenfalls den Wert von eigenen Erfahrungen schätzen zu lernen. Durch die Erfahrungen anderer habe ich eine gewisse Orientierung gewonnen. Der Wald hat eine enorme Fähigkeit der Selbstheilung, solange die Bäume kommunizieren. Der Austausch von Informationen und Weisheiten bildet eine noch stärkere und stabilere Überlebenschance für den Wald. Selbstheilung wird erreicht, wenn Mutter Natur eine Vielfalt von Arten und Strukturen hat. Die grünen Giganten beweisen uns, dass gegenseitige Unterstützung die beste Strategie ist, um sich weiterzuentwickeln. Zurück zu dem Baum, der so aussieht, als würde er für sich alleine kämpfen. Einzelkämpfer gibt es in der menschlichen Welt oft, welche nur auf sich bedacht und auf Kontrolle anderer hinaus sind. Der Gedankengang, dass nur Erfolg das Leben wertvoll macht, ist falsch. Und der entstehende Druck, erfolgreich sein zu müssen, weil du sonst nicht gut bist, beeinflusst die junge Generation von Anfang an. Herbert Renz-Polster, ein deutscher Kinderarzt und Wissenschaftler, betrachtet die erfolgsorientierte Denkweise von einem anderen Standpunkt. Er sagt, eine Generation, die zunehmend in den besten Lebensjahren mit Burnout zu kämpfen hat, entwirft für ihre eigenen Kinder einen Lebensweg mit noch mehr Tempo, noch mehr Leistung, noch mehr Förderung. Sie funktioniert Kindergärten zu Schulen um, weil sie glaubt, Kinder, die früh Mathe lernen, seien schneller am Ziel. Moment einmal, an welchem Ziel? Der Glaube, dass ich kein einzelner Wolf bin, sondern meinen speziellen Zweck und Platz habe, macht mich stark und sollte jedem, jeder Zuversicht schenken. Mit der Erkenntnis, nicht gegen andere zu kämpfen, sondern mit anderen, bringt mich in die Balance des Lebens.
Thank you.
Yeah, just a beautiful film. Some of the things I want to point out, I could make a whole list of, I could do a whole lesson just on this production from the start all the way through where it's ended up at this particular point a few years later. To start off with, she shot this entire thing before Lex came involved, and that's another part of the story that I just really love about it. But this started with a T6i. She did all of it with a T6i, except for the shots of her herself. They used a C100 and picked up those. But everything that you see that doesn't have her in it was with her student camera. No stabilizers, nothing rig-wise on her hikes. She was entirely handheld. but she also got really good at running through those things before she went on that road trip. She had practiced hundreds of hours with her camera, and then also mastered so much of her post-production skills that she was able to do stabilization in post. And there's only just a few little spots where the warp is noticeable, and the pixels didn't quite do what I would have, you know, liked them to do. It's really miraculous what she was able to do just handheld, and her ability to get that story with what she had. So kicking back to the very, very beginning, she wanted this to be an expository. That was the whole intention. In fact, her passion for it came from a TED Talks. And she actually reached out and got in touch with the TED Talks biologist that discussed how nature communicates and talks, trees talking to trees, mushrooms talking to mushrooms, and how that kind of that ecosystem works there, essentially like kind of an economy. And it was really fascinating. It motivated her like crazy. And then she found another scientist, and another biologist, I believe, that was interested in being interviewed as well. And so she was trying to figure out how to arrange this and get it to work, and then all of a sudden the communication dipped off. And she was like, I don't know what I'm going to do. I wanted to do this story so bad. I've researched it like crazy. She knew a whole lot about it at this point because she wanted to be really well educated for the interviews. She wanted to make sure that she knew a lot. Researched some of the things that they had written and their backstory so that she was on that page with them. At the same time, Alexis Cruz had put together a great concept called The Dude. And this is in our production management class, so keep in mind, 16 weeks long, you know, give or take. And Lex had lined up four actors, all from one of the local theater programs, not HCC, but and she needed these teenagers to fill out her film. Well, the teacher in that theater program found out that these students were gonna act in her short film for like one day and told all of them they would fail their theater class if they participated in that film. So Lex came in crying, didn't know what to do. Logically, she had written a script. She'd already shot a trailer for it with stand-in actors that just covered up their face, didn't shoot their faces a whole lot. I don't know if I've shown that trailer in this class, but I do show it in production management to talk about how things fall apart, and that's very much our industry. It doesn't have to be just live events moving the volleyball game. This is very much our world that we're in. So coincidentally, both of those ladies were running into very similar issues. They lost their talent that was motivating their story and the direction they wanted to go with it. And so they combined, and they got together. And so they repurposed it to being more from Leone's perspective. She'd done the research, she knew what she wanted to say, and went from this expository standpoint where they would interview people, for Nature Communicates, they would interview people and have them talk about their expertise with their understanding of how things work in nature. Put it into Leone's words as more of a motivational, inspirational thing. So they staged everything in her room. She was living with a host family at the time. So they staged all of that, had her writing, the candles and stuff like that. Then they went to Dillon Nature Center, and all of her walking through the forest, kind of contemplating life and those really beautiful shots. Those were all done at Dillon Nature Center. And then the rest of it was her and some friends went on a road trip through, I think, California, and hiked a lot of these major, really cool national forest, and I don't recall what all it was, like Yosemite, but I'd have to ask her to check. So with both of them dealing with adversity that essentially ruined both their projects that they had at that point. Weeks of planning, from script writing to contacting scientists to scheduling. Immediately, both of them in the same couple of days lost their project, as it were, as we had pitched. And so they came together and they made what I just think was a wonderful short film that has a way bigger story to it. But so often, there's a really fascinating story about how it got made. And in this particular case, I love the film, but I think just being a part as like a fly on the wall, helping just kind of going, keep going. They're not getting back to you. Lex also doesn't have actors. Like that, these two really did this themselves, overpowering that controversy that just ruined their productions as they had seen them going. And we're talking like both ladies had a lot of time invested before they got to this point. Before they even did the film itself, they really didn't know that either of them are going to be able to do this particular story. They had to sit and go, are we able to take your vision, and is that easier than trying to recast four actors and parts for this other film? And so I'm really proud of them for their adversity. Before they even made a really nice film, they had to really overcome some issues before that even happened. So what I want to wrap up with here, before we just go through the typical what's required for the class, I want you guys to help me figure out which of these last four it falls under. Does anybody have a thought before we look at all four of them? Let's see if you guys. If I go too much smaller, you won't go over here. Dang, I was hoping to stretch it out. The options, I can already tell you it's not poetic, even though it's kind of like a very poetic story, but not for the definition that we're looking for this particular mode. Expository, that's what she intended it to be, but when the scientist, or her talent, you know, subject matter experts, you know, whatever you refer to them as, a shmi, when they fell through, expository was no longer an option in that same capacity. You could argue in some ways it has expository components because of the narration, it's kind of the voice of God. But then number three, participatory. Should be pretty obvious, but are defined by the interaction between the documentary filmmakers and their subject. Therefore, a cinematographer is equally responsible for capturing interviews as they push the story along. I don't, again, the producers and the directors try to be listed as that. Aren't they known for interactive documentaries, often present filmmakers' vision as the truth? That's pretty interesting, right? For what we just watched, observational style of documentary, embraced by the cinema verite movement, observational documentaries attempt to discover the ultimate truth. Essentially, cinematographers on observational documentaries will often be asked to be as unobtrusive as possible. I would say, if I was thinking of one that I did a lot of, weddings, corporate events, athletics, those kinds of things. So any of my like live event world, I feel like kind of falls in observation. I think we can scratch that one because she literally thrust herself into nature to get the story. So I don't think that would work. Reflexive, focused on the relationship between the filmmaker and the audience, since the subject matter is often a process of documentary and filmmaking itself. So behind the scenes stuff, things like that. And you got her writing out her narration. Kind of seems like it has components of it. Performative, our last, not including the you guys, the number seven. What's the seventh option?
Mockumentaries.
Yeah. Thanks. They don't mention that here, but you guys are allowed to do that. I think Andrew has already decided. Just say, are you talking about this?
No.
I'll come back around to it when I do that.
Mockumentaries.
Yeah. I'll bring it up right before. Yeah, don't let me forget though. Performative, focus on the filmmaker's involvement with the subject. Right there, kind of stands out. Using his or her personal experience or relationship with the subject as a jumping off point, exploring larger subjective truths about the politics, history, or groups of people. In this case, not necessarily people, but there is objects.
that are alive and changing and evolving, and the story works around them. They're often asked to capture the documentary production process as well as intimate footage that illustrates the direct and often personal relationship between filmmaker and subject. So Super Size Me, anybody see Super Size Me? Yeah, that's a, that was a, I did a present, that came out when I was in high school, so.
They made a second one.
They what?
They made a second one.
Yeah, he had a series for a while too, like What Would You Do for 30 Days or something like that, yeah.
Yeah, they forced my class to watch it.
Forced?
So, yeah. Yeah.
Did that mean you didn't like it, or?
Well, I mean, it was still, it was pretty interesting to watch in general, but.
Yeah, it changed the way McDonald's marketed their value meals and stuff, so it had some effect. So where would you guys want to see, or where would you categorize Leone and Lex's Nature Communicates? I think we could rule out observational. We know that expository was what she intended on. Doesn't mean it still didn't have characteristics of it. And it's definitely not poetic. So between participatory, maybe reflexive a little bit, and performative, what do you guys think?
I think it's D6 because of the filmmaker's involvement.
That just because it's so much as, and like she really became the subject, or at least she became your host, right?
Yeah, she did.
So I could see 6. I think that's a good suggestion. What else? I mean, keep in mind there could be modes that hit different characteristics, maybe just not so much as others. What do you guys think?
I was kind of debating between performative and participatory.
Okay, so participatory and performative, so 3. Why about participatory? They're really similar in some capacity, yeah. Like it's almost kind of a gray area.
Like just like her involvement between the subjects.
Yeah, documentary filmmakers and their subject. I mean, she literally went out into nature and became part of it. I didn't go race a race car, you know, to tell the Nationals documentary. And unless I got a couple that are like about family members, I don't really want to be on camera. It's not really my notion, but she didn't either when she started, so.
And she's not really interviewing the subject, but still, like, when she's talking about it, she's showing the subject or what they're doing, the roots and the connectivity between all, so.
Yeah.
I was kind of bouncing between the two.
And that's, I think that's just fine, because if you read the last, last sentence, many of Michael Moore's documentaries, and obviously Fahrenheit 9/11 being really big, Bowling for Columbine, Mike and Me or something like that. There's a few. He tends to be very much incorporated in that film. So our participatory, but also blend elements of observational and performative. And this is far from Michael Moore getting on in like ranting about politics, but still, as far as documentary styles go, it's very similar. And I think in her case, she's kind of in that same category where it definitely has characteristics of more than one, which is great. you are not required to just pick, I'm doing poetic, I'm just doing participatory. But I wanted to show you these and give you some ideas that documentary is so broad and it's not just one certain thing, but there is different types in so many different ways. And this is not all encompassing in my opinion either. This is from the 90s. And I think there's a lot of other things. Mockumentary being the big one that I feel kind of being left out a little bit. And then the way documentary series are produced is a little different depending on how it's approached. But they all have characteristics of this. Your mockumentary could be poetic. Your mockumentary could be expository. I think the ones I've done, we can watch one of mine sometime, is usually a little more of the, oftentimes the character, we kind of make them, you know, they realize they're being filmed. They know that this is taking place. They know what's happening. I'd say they have more of a participatory approach to it in some cases. So, because they might communicate with the film crew, for instance. So, any thoughts about the modes, the 3 different stories we watched that cover different areas? Leone's covering a couple for us. I didn't have time to find one for all 6 or wanted to make you guys sit through 6 films. But any questions, thoughts there? Okay, so let me wrap up our day, because I know you guys had some questions or some thoughts. It may not be questions. Just start from the top. So it's a short documentary film. There's a lot of different things that, you know, we do pilot episodes for documentary series that come in shorter capacity. We do hype videos, things like that. There's other ideas, but I like the idea of you guys doing like a short film. If you think it's gonna be a way bigger story, then do like we did with the Nationals documentary that tends to be a feature, well, kind of Wycliffe, Kansas too, but it's really a chapter of what'll be all-encompassing, a larger story. So keep it brief in the fact of 2 to 10 minutes. Know what type of area you're going for. Is it gonna be mockumentary? Is it gonna be a poetic? And this one, you can absolutely do with a partner. You don't have to do it independently. Now, there's both examples. Leone and Lex started off doing their films independently, became partners through a circumstance, which I think made it just that much cooler of a story overall. Micro Kansas, I showed a rough cut to someone one time to get some feedback, and the direction they had wasn't even a bad suggestion, but they clearly didn't know what I was going for. So I didn't show it to anyone else other than my, at the time, 2-year-old, who I was quarantined with. She was the only one that knew where I was going with it. In that case, that story needed to be just my vision. I was getting too clouded if I brought in other people. I needed to focus in on my own. That was that circumstance. And then with the Grand Nationals documentary, that was co-directed, co-produced, co-edited, even a team of editors, if you consider all the different times. We had dozens of camera operators over the years help out with that. Even the police department brought their drone in for some of the shots another time, did us a nice favor. That one included half the damn community to make it. So it depends on where you want to go with it. And especially if you're going the mockumentary route, like if you guys want to work together, I think you'll have a lot of fun doing it. Yeah, go ahead.
Like, I kind of have a general idea of what it's
so I guess it makes me kind of feel bad I didn't show you an example. I'll show you an example, some examples. We can talk about it more. Essentially, you're making it seem factual, but it's fiction. And yeah, you can go pretty sarcastic with it, but you still have to do the proper things. You know, you have to get your interviews clean, you have to have your questions ready. Even if it's acting, you still gotta make sure that everything's in focus, everything's lit well. So as we go through this.
Like, still has to be produced well, like a real documentary.
Yeah, it's gotta be convincing, yeah. I don't care if you do something sarcastic and silly, as long as you keep going through all of these other things that I want you to do. So incorporate at least one audio source. At one point, I required this to be more of like you had to have an interview. And I'm kind of scratching that because of the poetic mode. And I think I don't want to rule that out as an option. But I'm definitely going to do an extensive workshop on interview setups in the process. That's probably over half of my production time is sitting in an interview setting. I got one today, doing something similar on Thursday. I do a lot of interviews, hundreds. And so that's made me a lot of money. It's got a lot of projects moving. So I'm gonna teach you that even if you choose to do poetic. But if you are using, if you wanna use just music or voiceover and not have an interview, that's okay. I do want an audio file incorporated. You're gonna locate or create additional supporting media relating to the subject matter, and we can go into more detail on how that would happen in mockumentaries. We've literally staged demonstrations. We've painted fake paint, well, the real paintings, but you know, supposed to be something, it's supposed to be with cat poop instead of actual paint. We used actual paint. So you have to accumulate and incorporate all of these things into your film, whether it's fake or not. Interviews must have proper exposure, focus, lighting to fit the mood. I'll go over 2, 3, 4 and natural point lighting and natural lighting. And then some of the optional items that everyone should probably incorporate. If you're not doing this, then your story is gonna be pretty bland. apply to film festivals. We can go into some of that process. Graphics, infographics, overlays, effects. So all of our NLEs, Canva's got great stuff. You can easily make graphics. You can easily create lower thirds. You can easily say the title of the film. And I personally, if you look at those three films I've shown, the one I mentored and the two I produced, the graphics are super, super clean and simple. basic, nothing overly gaudy, because that takes extra time and distracting if it's not working well. If it's bad, it's really bad, and if it's clean, no one's gonna walk out for that. So graphics, you should at least have a title. Multiple audio sources, so that would mean any of these, with the slight exception of Micro Kansas, you could have ambient sound, you could have interview dialogue, you could have a narration, you could have music, you could have sound effects, you can incorporate Foley. So multiple audio sources is really what I would nudge you towards, but not gonna make you stress too much about that, if not. And then multiple interviews. Most stories that are short in form really only need one good subject matter in a lot of cases. But if I'm interviewing, say, this muralist, and I want to interview him, but in this case we did one with Brady Scott, super talented muralist in town. I really wish we would have had more time to interview his wife and some of his kids, some of the people that also will help him or be around it. And in our case, we ended up, his daughter provided, as like an 11, 12-year-old, provided a bunch of footage of him around the state doing murals. She would film him with their family camera. And so she got a cinematography credit, but I wish we would have had time to sit down and interview her too. It's great if you can. If you can't, you just make sure you have a good, at least a good subject matter expert, whether it's on themselves or whether it's on, you know, nature or something. But multiple interviews is encouraged, but you can easily, and I was just talking to Adam about this the other day, you can easily overdo it. I've had multiple projects that have more than a dozen interviews. Sometimes you gotta sift through the duds. Sometimes you feel obligated to give everyone a little bit of time. That's a pain. So don't overdo the interviews, but if you can set them down and you can schedule them and you can arrange them, then it'll absolutely benefit your project. It's better to not use it than to not have it. Okay, and we'll go over all this stuff a lot more as we keep moving. I kept you guys a little late. Sorry about that. Any questions? No? Okay, you look like you need to run. Okay. Have a nice day. Thursday, we'll keep powering through. At this point, you don't have to know what you're doing yet, but going into Thursday, you'll definitely want to know where you're headed with your stuff.